Thank you. So, why do we find faces so fascinating? It's because the face is the mirror of the brain. Everything that happens on your face is as the result of some internal activity. It's your mind revealing itself, your hopes and desires. It's revealing your inner life. Now, I got first interested in how your inner life gets revealed on your face when I was working on a short film. And this is a short film. We were trying to do digital aging on a character. And basically, we're taking a 20-year-old woman and making her 80, much to her horror. But, and put this in context, this is about 10 years before the film Benjamin Button. But the point of this was, could we get people to think about what the character was thinking rather than thinking that they're looking at a computer-generated person? And so it got me really interested in this. What is giving the feeling of consciousness? What is revealing the sort of soul of the character through its behavior on the face? And so it's really like, how does the symphony of facial movements get created by the brain? And thinking about it, it's like the behavior that we see really emerges as a result of multiple systems operating on different scales. Low-level biology is just as important as high-level social interactions. These things all interact from the bottom up to the top down. Is it possible to make models to integrate these factors? So I set up a lab called the Laboratory for Animate Technologies, and what we're doing is we're putting models of the brain together with models of the face. And we're doing this to basically explore ideas and theories of brain function and disorder through computational modeling, but also we're embodying them, we're making them interactive. And so it also provides us with a more natural way of interacting with technology. So we're combining bioengineering, neuroscience, sensing, and computer graphics. So to give a sort of overview of the system, we're building essentially a framework to construct artificial nervous systems. So we sense the world through how we sense the world is constrained by our anatomy. Our eyes get electromagnetic radiation, ears, vibrations, and so forth. In the electronic world, anything could be an input. Our brain puts these together, and then we basically evaluate them with emotion and motivational systems to create behavior. One of the things which really hasn't been looked at is how that behavior is expressed. The importance of expressing behavior is in communication. This is why we talk to each other. It's to sort of pass mental models. So we want to put the user in the loop because it's a dyadic interaction. It's a to and fro thing. We co-create our experiences. And I see the face as an instrument. And so really what we're doing is building a synthesizer. The strings of the synthesizer, the strings of the instrument, are really the muscles of the face. And so we started building models of this, and so we decided we'd go hardcore at it, and so this is an MRI model of my face, and I sat in an MRI machine smiling for 15 minutes, which is actually a very positive experience. We also built systems to look at how the muscles were deforming under the skin. This is an ultrasound system. And we put them together in a mathematical model of the face. So everything that you're looking at here, apart from the blood vessels, is part of a physical simulation of the face, how the face works, how all these elements come together. Now, it's my face because I was a guinea pig. But basically, once these things are built up, then we can start activating the muscles and create expressions. So we're literally putting mathematical sort of signals into these muscles to create that activity. And then we can start sort of activating these muscles in all kinds of combinations to create all kinds of different movements. And the physics model is basically doing collision and things like that. So anyway, the thing is what really interested me was, how does the brain control the face? Now, so what we started looking at is really nerve animation. It's like those signals which pass through to the face are the result of many interacting systems. It's quite redundant systems. But by doing it in this way, we can even model things like stroke, how stroke affects the face, and various neurological conditions, because we're going through the anatomical pathways. Now, but the core thing is, how does behavior get created? What is the core of why people do anything? So we wanted to build models of emotion and motivation and learning and all the types of things which drive our behavior. So I call these neurobehavioral models. And what I mean by that is, if my blood sugar level drops low, I'll experience the sensation of hunger. And then I will start searching for food. So my homeostatic physical level is creating behavior. Now, that's just one example of how these things combine. Now, you bring this up, and you start looking at models of how we learn things, how we interact, and they're all interconnected. And so, for an example of a part of the brain which we're modeling, which basically drives things like, why do you choose to do a particular action? Well, there's part of the brain called the basal ganglia, and what it does is it learns a thing called reinforcement learning. You know, if I do something which works, I'll probably do it again. You know, if I do something which I got punished for, I probably wouldn't do it again. You know, some people would, but we can model that. Now, the other things that we want to look at is what's driving emotion. So the way we're taking, the angle that we're taking on this is really a physiological model. So we're looking at things like how the stress system works. You know, basically, you get stressed, your body starts producing cortisol. This influences your future behavior. These are part of the determinants of what happens next. And the brain also makes maps of the world. As we experience the world, we create mental maps. Now, if you look in the sort of top left corner, you'll see a bunch of random colours. I'm just going to hit go, and this is essentially competitive learning simulation of what the cortex does, and it self-organises. All we've done is put data in. It's self-organised. Those colours could be similar concepts. They could be similar sounds. The body is constantly making maps. There's a very famous homunculus that everybody's probably seen, which is how the brain maps the body onto the somatosensory cortex. Now, if you start building layers of these, you start getting hierarchical models and you get deeper and deeper levels of meaning. Now, there's a sort of a machine learning analog to this, which is called deep learning, which is what companies like Google use to create their image searches and things like that. So this technology is coming more and more into our life, but it has biological analogs. And then we start looking at things like memory. You know, how does memory work? How do I remember specific events in a sequence? It's part of the brain called the hippocampus. It's like the brain's librarian. Let's go, there's a book by an author, their name starts with A, and then the brain just fills in the gaps. And then you start remembering sequences of events. So you can look at the sort of neurobiological structure of this and start seeing what the brain might be doing. So there's theoretical models of how this works. So I'll show you a model where what we've done is train the model on a sequence, and we're just going to give it a 1 and see if it can remember. So I'm just presenting it with a 1, and what you're seeing happening here is the brain's imagining. It's what's the next thing in the sequence. This is how we plan things. This is how we imagine things. But these are sort of processes that we can get an insight on through the computational modeling. Now, there's been lots of really interesting computational neuroscience models developed for research. What happens if we take some of these most practical ones and we embody them in an interactive system? So we've basically built a Lego system for brain modeling, and we're calling it brain language. And it allows us to put these different models together and interconnect them and try things out, just see how they work together. Now, so I may need audience participation for the next part of the talk. No, just joking. What we're doing here is we're going, okay, how do we embody this in the simplest way? And, you know, we don't want to deal with adult baggage, so we'll just start simple with a baby. Now, so here's a real baby doing baby stuff. And now, this is the very first time the baby has had solid food. It's a fundamentally new experience. Everybody saw that, and everybody gets that. What happens if when a computer learns something, its eyes light up? We'll start connecting with its excitement about learning something. This is more baby capture. Building a biomechanical model of a baby. Now, we activate the biomechanical's baby's muscles because you can't get real babies to do what you want. And then we start putting in some of these different brain models, sort of like models of how the eyes move, how we choose behavior, and so forth. And so we put all the pieces together. Now I'll just do a short demo. And what we're seeing now is, this will take about a minute to start up, but basically what it's doing is it's creating a brain model, and it's interconnecting all the parts. So what you're going to see when it's running is you're going to see neural networks creating everything from the muscle movements to how it's responding, and they're all interconnected. So here she is. Hello. Yep. So she's 3D. We can zoom around, move the light around. So she can see me and hear me. So let's go here and you can see what she's actually looking at. So see here? And hey, sweetheart, the smile at her. Now she's not copying my smile, she's responding to my smile. We've got different sorts of neuromodulators which you can see up here. So for example, I'm going to abandon the baby. I'm just going to go away and she's going to start sort of wondering where I've gone. And if you watch up where the mouse is, you should start seeing cortisol levels and other sorts of neuromodulators rising. So she's going to get increasingly serious. This is a mammalian sort of maternal separation distress response. It's okay, sweetheart. It's okay. Oh, it's okay. Hey, it's okay. Now, she's also, you know, she's listening to me too. So, you know, she can get a loud noise. You know, she get a fright. This type of stuff. So, now let's take a look. Now, because this brain model, she can learn. We can do types of things like Pavlovian learning. So, what I'm going to do now is a simple response. So, here's an unconditioned, a sort of a conditioned stimulus. It's a bell. It's a neutral stimulus. Now, hey, sweetheart, the bell is good. Yeah, the bell is good. Hey, hey. Okay. And now, I've got to give her a bit. Hey, sweetheart. Yeah, you. Oh, no, don't get it. Oh, she's scared because of the noise. This is the thing, you never know what's going to happen. This is a, hey, hey. Sweetheart, you like the bell? Yeah, you do. Now, okay, you just, hey. Well, she's actually kind of got mixed because what happened was it was so loud, she was getting stressed at the same time, so she didn't really know what she wanted to do. So let's, hey. There you go. Sus. Now, we can also sort of, we're going to look and see what she's looking at here, and now we can also see what's kind of running live behind her face. Now, this is watching me. So what you're seeing is the live sort of model moving, and you're seeing like the brainstem nuclei. This is the oculomotor nuclei, and they're responding. They're creating the saccades of the eyes as they move around. We can kind of see how this is all running live. Move around. Come back here, there's a visual cortex, so you can see we've kind of mapped that on there. Now if we zoom into the brain, you actually see the brain stem. And this part of the brain here is called the superior colliculus. It's where the brain maps the world onto your body in a way. And it's what directs our attention. So different things are competing. So you can see this neural field here. And there's things like my movement, and it's looking at me, and there's noises and things like that happening. And these are all being put together, and these eventually direct where the eyes look. Now, we come out of this, and we kind of see, this is part of the brain here, frontal eye fields, and they're basically going and directing where the eyes want to look. This goes down through part of the brain called the basal ganglia, which basically either reinforces or inhibits behavior. Now, with these models that we're using, we can do things like adjust the dopamine level. So I'm going to bump up the dopamine. And now what I'm doing here is it's now giving too much feedback. Now, this is what happens in diseases like Huntington's disease. The brain is getting, it's activating every muscle at once, so the body's shaking and moving too quickly. Now if we put this right down, drop the dopamine right down, this is like Parkinson's disease. The brain wants to move the body, but the body's not responding. So these are sort of elements that of how these factors, we can put them in and show that how they affect behavior. Now, if we come out of the face now, and we can look at some of the other sort of how things like the dopamine level affects other parts of the model. So I'm going to zoom into her eyes here. And then I'll just move it so you can't see the light there. Now, what I'm going to do is bump up the dopamine levels. So this is actually the equivalent of giving the baby cocaine. And you see what's happening, the pupils are dilated, she's blinking faster, these are sort of clinical markers. This is all interconnected. The dopamine is a learning signal in the brain, but it also affects, hey, it's okay, sweetheart, it's okay. Now, hey, hey, hey. Okay. Now, the other sorts of things we've been doing is, oh, she can also, like, you know, she's learning to various words. So if I say here, good baby, yeah. Now if I say bad, 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 bad. Now she's avoiding me now. Bad baby, no. Yeah. Yes, it's okay. It's okay. Yes, yes, it's good. Daddy didn't mean it. Yes, yes. Okay. So now another thing that I'm gonna show you now is that she's also been kind of learning to read. So here's her first words book. So you know, we're in New Zealand, so first word to learn is sheep, right? So let's have a look. So we just I'll just go to a different view, and we can actually kind of see what she's looking at here. Okay. Okay, baby. What's this? What's this? Could you hear that? What's this? Good girl. Reading words? Okay, sweetie, what's this? What's that? Come on. Good girl. Let's try another one. Okay. Hey, baby, what's this? What's this? Good girl. Now we keep going, we, you know, here we go. Hey, what's this? What's this?
Look.
Good girl. Okay, so this is now learning to imitate expression. So what the baby's doing now is she's babbling, making movements. I, as the caregiver, am copying her expressions. Now she's learnt to associate that, so now she's copying my expressions. So from first principles, she's learnt to copy me. Now we're doing another thing here. This is the video game Pong, right? So this is a game where she doesn't know, but we've connected her brain to the bat, right? She doesn't know that it's like a baby which will move its arm around, and it's babbling, and it just starts learning the association between its mental activity and the arm. And she starts getting a reward when she hits it. So she starts learning to play. And now this is, I took it to my daughter's school, and this is what the baby was seeing as the kids interacted with it. And, oh, they're blue because of a bug, but it was too cool to fix. But basically, but what was really fun about that experience was, I'll just play that again, because it's like, it's showing how people are seeing computers, but it's also showing a subjective view of experience. Now, the other really interesting thing about taking it to, like, showing 9-year-olds this, was they got a really good appreciation of what a nervous system is by showing it. They got to see almost like their body in action. Now, we can also put it on characters and things like that, and we can basically create realistic models for different types of applications. And, oh, this is a fantastic team I'm working with. We're having a couple of curries here. And it wouldn't be possible without the team. So, but what I wanted to end with is that what we're doing, in a way, is showing how everything's connected. We're showing how low-level biology is connected to higher-level social activity. We're showing how these, increasingly, are now connected to technology. So we have a sort of, it sort of points to some of the futures of technology. It's this increasing interconnectedness of everything. Thank you.